I have a dollar bill.
What?
Who's excited about a dollar bill? Okay. How many of you have smelled a dollar bill before? Anybody sniffed a dollar bill? Anybody know what? Thank you, Chelsea, for being brave enough to raise your hand. Okay, so if you haven't sniffed a dollar bill, go ahead and pull one out and sniff it. I'm just joking, you don't have to do that. But if you're aware of the smell of money, you know that the smell of money is difficult to pinpoint, right? Like, the smell of money is difficult to be like, what is the smell of money? And some people are like, it smells like this, no, it smells like this, no, it smells like this. This is something I learned this week that has baffled perfume experts. Apparently there are perfume experts who are concerned about the smell of money, and they can't quite nail it down. But there's some guy who decided to do some research, and he had like some laboratory that had some charcoal in it, and he put a dollar bill in a charcoal thing, and it took out the scents, and he was able to pinpoint what some of the scents in a dollar bill, what some of the smells in a dollar bill, or $5, $10, any U.S. currency might be. And these are some of the things he said. He said that the smell of money includes leather wallets. They spend a lot of time in leather wallets. It includes butter. Some people are smelling butter in money. Cheese. Cheese. You ever sniffed a dollar bill and thought, cheesy, right? Like, sweaty palms. That was one of them. So sweaty palms. I'm holding it right now. My hands might be sweaty. Sweaty palms. Now, one of the things he also said, he said this. There was soap in it as well. He said that even though it is kind of an urban legend that 78% of bills test positive for cocaine, he's like, that's not true. It's like, they don't all test positive for cocaine. But he said he was surprised at the amount of fecal matter on dollar bills that he found. So, there you go. There's poop on dollars. You're like, okay, Jason, really? You went from like telling us we need to love each other to talking about poop on dollar bills. What are you trying to do? Here's the deal. If you try to pinpoint the one smell that comes from a bill, you won't be able to do it because there's multiple smells that come from a dollar bill. In the same way with some of these issues that we talk about, these hot button cultural issues that we talk about, if you try to pinpoint one solution or one problem, it won't work. If you try to say, oh, that's the problem and that's the solution, it's like saying, well, money smells like soap when it actually smells like 49 other things as well. So yeah, soap's in there, but it's not the entirety of the problem. And what happens is when it comes to some of these things, we want to just generalize and be like, here's the problem, here's the solution, when that is a problem and a solution, but there's so many more factors at play here. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. This is a very, very, very famous parable. It's the parable of the Good Samaritan. Most of you have heard it before. And what we're going to see as we begin to play this out is we're going to see the Bible begin to instruct us to view the issue we're going to talk about today holistically. And what I mean by that is not just look at it from one angle, one point of view, but look at it from multiple point of view, so that we as a church, when we enter into these issues, we can be holistic in our approach. We can address it from all these different problems. Because I don't want us as Christians to think that in a broken world where Satan is roaming free trying to create chaos, it's what the Bible tells us, that there is one solution to every problem. He's sowing chaos. And so what happens when you sow chaos, there's all sorts of issues that take place. And the issue we're going to talk about today, as we observe this week, the 44th anniversary of when the Supreme Court legalized abortion on demand across the country in all 50 states from the Roe versus Wade decision. And what we're going to talk about today is the sanctity of life. And we want to drive a stake in the ground this week and talk about that because we as a church, we want to address it, but we want to address it holistically. And so that's why as a church, we've got to talk about the Good Samaritan. We've got to talk about different factors at play here. Now, what happens is the one factor that the conservative Christian church is normally focused on is the factor of the ballot box. And what I mean by that is every 4 years we get charged up about this issue, and then we kind of let it fall by the wayside over the 3.5, 4 years that pass between elections. But see, as a church, yeah, we should absolutely be concerned about voting and laws and all those things. But we should also recognize that politics follow culture, right? It's not the other way around. To think that politics, you know, is the one that's leading culture is really thinking that the tail's wagging the dog. That's not the way it works. See, if you follow politics and you follow culture, culture is usually one step ahead of politics. So if we really want to see change on this issue, we got to speak truth into the culture at large, and politics will never be followed. But that's usually the way we want to talk about this. But we forget the grace of God. We forget that there's not just a human being in the womb, but there's a human being carrying that human being. Well, we forget those other factors. We forget to preach grace to those who've had abortions. We forget to enter in and to seek justice for those who are very possibly considering an abortion. We just want to talk about the baby, and we should talk about the baby. Absolutely, yes and amen, and we're going to. But simultaneously, we shouldn't forget the mom. We shouldn't forget the brokenness in the society and the way that the man who was willing to lay around but not willing to stay around. We shouldn't forget these factors as well as we talk about these things. Now, this is our third year talking about it. And what I want to do real briefly as we get into it is give us a theological reminder as to why we believe that as soon as the sperm hits the egg, that's life. Why it's not just some clump of cells into some ambiguity, week 20 deal where all of a sudden it changes from a clump of cells to a human being. Why we don't believe that. Why that actually just seems illogical and crazy. And here's why. Let me read two verses. Genesis chapter 9, verse 6. It says this: whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image. Okay, so we all know the Ten Commandments, Exodus chapter 20, verse 3, don't murder. Here's why. God made man in his own image. That's why it's okay to go out and kill a cow and have steak, but it's not okay to go kill a human and eat, you know, like that's kind of gross to think about. But that's why there's an image pair of godness implanted into all of us. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean that we look like God? Like Avery, we were reading the Jesus storybook Bible the other night. She looked at me, she goes, what does God look like? I'm like, well, actually, God the Father is spirit. And if you want to know what God looks like, you look at Jesus because he has a body. And I didn't think she was listening, but she actually repeated that the next day. I was like, yes, that is awesome. We're getting theologically deep here in the Jesus storybook Bible. But when it says that we're made in his image, it doesn't necessarily mean that like he has a body, even though Jesus does. What that means is that the characteristics that are inherent inside of us come from him. And one of those characteristics is a morality. Right and wrong. Remember Genesis chapter 2, they'll be like us, knowing good from evil? That's us as human beings. That's a part of us being made in the image of God. So where there is both good morality and bad morality present, the image of God is present. So when there is a bad morality or a sinfulness present in us, that means the image of God is present because there is in fact a morality there. Now, keep that in mind. Look at Psalm 51:5. It says this. David's writing. He says, behold, I was brought forth in iniquity and in sin did my mother conceive me. Now, David's mama was not cheating on David's daddy. That's not the point of this text right here. The point of this text is that as soon as David was conceived, sin was present. The moment David was conceived, a morality was present. And the moment that David was conceived, the image of God was present. That's where this comes from. That's where this whole idea comes from. And science is catching up. We're going to talk about that in just a second. But when we begin to realize this, it begins to change our perspective about what's going on around this debate. And it should. And we should begin to talk about this. And I mean, personally, I've shared with y'all this story before. Between Avery and Hadley, Colleen and I had a miscarriage. It was about 15 months before Hadley was born. And I can remember, we found out Colleen was pregnant, we were so excited, and we were also like, we're absolutely crazy, we're having a second kid, and now it's like, we're absolutely crazy, we have three, and one day it'll be like, we have seven, I'm just joking, kind of. But I remember we found out we were pregnant, she was so excited, it was great, and we went in, we had to go in a week early for the ultrasound because she had a stomach bug. And so we went in a week early for the ultrasound, and this was like at 6.5, 7 weeks. I still had the ultrasound, but we heard a heartbeat. 6.5, 7 weeks. Boom, 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 boom. We could hear it on the ultrasound. It's crazy. I mean, the little baby looked like a peanut or a cashew or something, but yet there was a heartbeat there. And we went back a week later because the doctor told us, he was like, look, you probably don't want to tell anybody because the heart rate's low and that's not normally a good sign. But I mean, we didn't think anything of it. We were just like, yeah, everything will be fine. And we went back a week later and they told us that she had miscarried. But when I look back on that scenario, I don't think that it was like, Colleen had to have a clump of cells removed or had to have a tooth removed or something like that. Like, that was a child. There was a beating heart there. And I think we all know that. I think that's why there's so much brokenness surrounding this issue. I think that's why even pro-abortion people try to take away the shame that's there, but there's still a shame there because we know what's really going on deep down in our hearts. Now, Jesus, his grace, his mercy takes away the shame. That's a part of our ministry to the world and to people who've had abortions, absolutely. But yet, we've got to call a spade, and we've got to call abortion what it is. So let's look at our text real quick. We're gonna kind of blaze through this real quick, and then we're gonna see how it applies and how we should love our neighbor. Number one, inherit eternal life. It's a question. Inherit eternal life. Now, I can remember high school finals. I got really good at high school finals doing grade calculations. And what I meant by that is I could figure out what the lowest grade that I could make on the final was in order to get the grade that I needed in the class, right? So I'd come to a scenario and I'd have, okay, I need to get a 97 to get an A in the class. Or I'd need to get a 16 and I could have a B in the class. And it was mathematically impossible for me to have anything lower than a C. So you know what? I didn't study, and I got above a 16, right? Like, that was my mentality. I was like, what's the least amount of work I can do and still get what I need to get out of this? And I'll tell you, when you're procrastinating, especially when it comes to studying, TV shows are a lot funnier, food tastes a lot better, any distraction device that you can come up with is so much more fun when you have all this studying to do. And I realized that, and my grades showed it. But that's human nature in a certain way. What's the least amount of work I can do to keep the job? What's the least amount of work I can do to collect my pension? What's the least amount of work I can do to get the grade? What's the least amount of work I can do to have the six pack? What's the least amount of work I can do to keep the cholesterol down? Right? Like, what's the least amount of work? What's the threshold I need to cross? Well, when it comes to spiritual things, there's a lawyer in the Bible who has the same question. He comes to Jesus in verse 25 of Luke 10. He says this, "And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying to Jesus, 'Teacher, what shall we do to inherit eternal life?'" What shall we do? What shall we do? Now notice that, because what this lawyer thinks is that eternal life is earned and not freely given by the grace of God. So he doesn't, from the start, he doesn't understand what Jesus is trying to teach. But what he's ultimately asking is, he's saying this, he's saying, what's the least amount I can do and get into heaven? Now, he's trying to trap Jesus, because the way that Jesus was teaching, he was teaching like, hey, you can have the kingdom of God right now. You don't have to wait until you die and the scales of justice prevail in your favor or against you. Because that was the thought in that culture, and honestly, that's the thought in our culture today. Most people in our culture today, what do they think? Well, I need to do enough good to outweigh the bad. And if I do enough good to outweigh the bad, then when I get to heaven, the scales will show that and everything will be good. But there's no way to know that until I get to heaven. So when people look at Christians who've given their lives to Jesus and they're like, you know, Christians are like, hey, Jesus loves me. I know I'm going to heaven when I die. They look at us and they're like, you're incredibly arrogant. How can you think that you're good enough now that you're 100% certain that you go to heaven when you die? And we're like, no, we actually think we're bad enough that Jesus needed to save us. But see, most of the world doesn't understand that. And that's why this guy's trying to trap Jesus, because he thinks Jesus is teaching a cheap salvation that you can have now, that you don't have to work for. But Jesus actually turns it around on the guy, because Jesus is God. He's smart like that. Verse 26, Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? How did you read it?" So he asks the lawyer what the law says. Verse 27, and he, the lawyer, answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." So at first we're like, okay, lawyer, you got it. That's good. That's exactly what the law says. If you're going to summarize the Old Testament laws and all the Old Testament teachings, that's the perfect way to do it. Right there. That's it. Because there's like 700 something laws. But if you're going to summarize it, underneath all of those laws is love God and love other people. Because if you love other people, you don't murder. If you love God, you don't worship idols. I mean, it's underneath all of the laws. And he summarizes it perfectly. Now Jesus in verse 28, watch what he does. And he said to him, "You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live." Now, if we think about this verse for a second, Jesus has just laid the impossible on the guy. Go perfectly love God and go perfectly love your neighbor, and you will have eternal life. That's the way to heaven. And you know what? If we are honest with ourselves, and I know some of us struggle to do that, we live in a place of self-deception. I've heard it said that the strongest form of deception is self-deception. But if we can be honest with ourselves, none of us have done this week. None of us have done this today. Every one of us have failed. failed to love our neighbor as ourselves or to love God the way that we should. All of us, me included, especially me. I can give you a list of ways that I've failed people and I've failed to love God well. This is impossible, and that was the point that Jesus was trying to make. See, the lawyer was like, Jesus, you believe in a cheap salvation, and Jesus is like, no, I don't. This is how you earn it. And what should have happened is that the lawyer should have been, oh my gosh, I can't do that. Is there a way to be saved? That's what should have taken place. But number two, this is what takes place. Justification. Justification. Verse 29. But he, the lawyer, deciding to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Now, when we're confronted with a situation where we know we're beat, where we know we're wrong, where we know we can't live up to the standards, we love to justify ourselves. So, 16 days ago, we had a snow day, right? Snow day, what? My car was in the shop, so I went and to drive. Her car had all-wheel drive, and I figured, hey, it's going to snow. I'm totally going to drive in it, because that's what I do when it snows. So I'm going to borrow her car. So I went and borrowed a car, and that morning I got up, and I was like, well, it's snowing, but I'm going to go to the gym. The kids are still asleep. By the time I get home, they'll wake up. We'll go play in the half an inch of snow, and we'll all get cold, tired, and cry. It'll be great. So I was like, we'll go to the gym. So I get in the car. I'm starting driving off to the gym, and I'm at the corner of Miller Farms in Neshoba in Germantown. Some of you know where that is. But I'm taking a left, and there's snow all over the ground, and all these crazy people like me are trying to commute to work. And so I go through the corner, and I give it a little bit too much gas, and the back of the car just starts to have a mind of its own. And I'm like, oh no, this isn't my car, it's my mom's car, oh no, no, no. And I just see the curb coming closer and closer, and then boing, right up against the curb, it's the car. Now, I got out and I was like, what was that that just impacted the curb? So I get out in my shorts and t-shirt in the snow because I'm going to the gym. And I run around the car and I look, and the car had, the tire actually had hit the curb. So it didn't do any body damage, but it bent the rim in a little bit. We got it fixed, but we bent the rim in a little bit. But you know what? On the way to the gym, I started thinking. I was like, you know what? It's the snow's fault. You know what? It's the tire's fault that I did that. You know what? It was this fault or that fault or the person who was coming. I was trying to get out of their way. Da 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 da. What I was trying to do was justify the situation, justify the fact that I was behind the wheel when the car hit the curb. Now, we all do that. Now, was the snow a factor? Absolutely. I don't think I would have skidded around the intersection if it wasn't snowing. Tires might have been a factor. You know, my judgment might have been a factor. All these things, right? But ultimately, at the end of the day, I was behind the wheel. And what we try to do so often is we try to pass the blame for our own struggles and our own sins on somebody else or something else. And those factors might have played a role. But ultimately, what does the Bible say? The Bible says we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So we want to blame our parents, or we want to blame our teacher, or we want to blame the school, or we want to blame our work, or we want to blame our boss, or we want to blame the government, or we want to blame the weather, or we want to blame this, that, or the other things. And those things might all be a factor, but what have you done with the things you can't control? What have you done with your response to those things? And when we begin to look at it, what happens is we actually see sin underneath there. But see, the lawyer was doing the same thing we try to do, which is justify ourselves. But look at what he says. Jesus says to him in verse 30, Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. So there is actually a road that runs from Jerusalem to Jericho. It descends over 17 miles. It descends 3,000 feet. And it was apparently a very shady road. There was a lot of taverns and caves and hideouts, and people oftentimes got beaten on that road. Like this was a very real scenario that Jesus paints. Verse 31. Now by chance, a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed on the other side. Verse 32. Likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place, he saw him and passed by the other side. So there's this man, Jewish man, this Jewish priest and this Jewish Levite, they pass by this broken, beaten man on the side of the road. And these were two people, you would have heard this, those were the two people you would have expected to stop. Those are the people you would have expected to help. It's like if you have a flat tire on the interstate, and you see like the big T-Dot, the yellow truck that drives by, those are the people that are supposed to stop, right? Like if you have road help, they're supposed to help you in that scenario. But it's like just watching them drive on by when you need help. That's the scenario that Jesus paints. But look at verse 33, it says, but a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, the man lying on the ground, and when he saw him, he had compassion. Now this is where the story takes a crazy turn, because the Samaritans and the Jews, they hated each other. We all know this. But to draw like a parallel, it would be the race relations struggles that we see today, or the big political divide that we see today. It'd be like somebody, you know, laying on the ground with a Make America Great Again hat, and this person drives by in their car that says Stronger Together on the bumper sticker, and having that person stop for the other person. That's the kind of divide and cultural division that was taking place in this scenario, if we're going to be honest. And so what happens is, we got the Samaritan of all people stopping. But it's not just that he stops, he has compassion. We'll come back to that. 34, he went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, and then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, take care of them, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when you come back. So not only does he look down off of his animal and have some pity on the man, the compassion leads him to action. He gets off the animal, puts him on the animal, takes him to an inn, and pays for him to get better. This is crazy and unheard of. So then Jesus, after the story, he does this. He looks at the lawyer and he says, which of the three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? The lawyer said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. Go and do likewise. This is our marching orders. Number 3, marching orders. So what this shows us is that we as Christians, who have been saved by the grace of God, because we can't save ourselves, we can't justify ourselves, we are to go and love our neighbor. Who's your neighbor? Everybody. That's the point. If this was a Jewish person coming up upon a Jewish person on the road, this wouldn't have been groundbreaking. But these were two enemies looking one loving the other. That's what it means to love your neighbor. It's not just love your friends, but love your foes. Not just to care for the people that look like you, act like you, talk like you, but to love everybody. Back in the Roman Empire, about 1,700 years ago when Christianity was spreading, there was a Roman emperor named Julian. And Julian, as the leader of a country, he was concerned about his country's religious aspect because paganism, it was waning. And this was kind of a religion of the Roman Empire because Christianity was exploding. And so Julian, he wrote a letter to a friend of his before Julian actually gave his life to Jesus. He wrote a letter to a friend of his, and he says, we can't stop the spread of Christianity, because while we as pagans can't even take care of our own poor, the Christians are not only taking care of their own poor, but they're taking care of everybody else's poor, including ours. And because people saw that, they were willing to listen to what the Christians had to say about the gospel. They were willing to engage, they were willing to love, they were willing to give their lives to Christ. And see, we as Christians, that should be our posture. We should be willing to love everyone, regardless of if they look like us, act like us, talk like us, or in the same stage of life as us, if we would normally cross paths with them or not, we're called to love them. Now, that includes everybody. So you know what that includes? That includes babies in the womb who don't have a voice. That includes babies in the womb who don't have a voice. Because if life begins at a conception, then that is a human being, and we're called to love that person as we love ourselves. And what that means is that we as people, we should be a voice for the voiceless in all scenarios, including that one. Because even science is showing us that that's a human being. Some of the scientific facts that I've collected over the years is that at the moment of fertilization, the unborn baby has a separate DNA code. Separate DNA code. 21 days after fertilization, the heart starts to beat. There's a heartbeat 3 weeks in. A heartbeat. Brain waves are present 6 weeks after fertilization. And 8 weeks after fertilization, every organ is in place. And the baby can even feel pain. Like you can see in an ultrasound when they prick the baby to take blood, it recoils in pain. Meaning that it recoils from the same devices we use to abort it. At 8 weeks. And most abortions, a large majority of abortions, happen after 8 weeks. And what this means is we need to fight for them. We need to speak up when we see the greatest Holocaust the world has ever known. Since Roe versus Wade, in the 44 years, over 50 million babies have been aborted. And oftentimes the church just stands by and says nothing. And that's not good. And then what's happened is I've started to have conversations with people who don't think the way I do. And I really enjoy doing that in a civilized manner where we don't get red-faced and block each other on Instagram. So I've been having a conversation with somebody I know who's an avowed atheist. And not the type of atheist where it's like, my parents love Jesus and I hate my parents, so therefore I'm an atheist. Like, we've all run into those atheists before, but I'm talking about like the atheist who's really thought through their position and can intellectually explain it. And I've asked him, I said, look, man, tell me about abortion. Like, what do you think about this? And he's like, look, I don't want to take away the choice in the scenario, but I do feel uneasy about it. There's something about it that it just makes me feel very icky. And this is coming from somebody who doesn't have a Christian worldview. Why? Because science is showing us these things. I do believe in my lifetime abortion will be outlawed because I think science is going to continue to show these things. And my prayer is that this wouldn't become a political issue, but it would become a bipartisan issue. That both sides of the aisle would recognize what we're talking about, would join forces, join hands, and say, no more in this country are we going to let legally this continue to happen. That's my prayer. And I think we're just a couple of decades away from seeing that come to fruition. But until then, we've got to still having these conversations. We've got to keep pointing out these inconsistencies. Because I don't know if you heard this story. A couple months ago, Target unleashed a new ad campaign. And in the ad campaign, they featured kids with Down syndrome, which is great. And society and culture applauded that, rightfully so. But did you know that 90% of fetuses that are shown to have Down syndrome are aborted in America? It's even higher overseas, 96% in France. And in France, when they tried to release an ad campaign in France just thanking parents of Down syndrome babies for, oh, I thought that was going to fall. We're okay. Cat-like reflexes. But what I was saying was, in France, the babies of Down syndrome moms, they put together this ad campaign to thank the parents of Down syndrome kids. And the France government outlawed it. They said, we can't have this because so many of these babies are being aborted. We can't have this ad campaign. These are things that are actually happening. And it shows the inconsistency in the thinking. And this doesn't just affect life at the beginning of life, but it's also at the end of life. I don't have time to go into this. But the thinking is, if this baby's an inconvenience, I'm going to get rid of it. It also can be extended to the end of life to think that this elderly person's an inconvenience. We should get rid of them as well. There was an article in the Washington Post that was run right before the election, because in Washington, D.C., they were voting on the Right to Die Acts. And the African-American community stood up and said, we know that this is unfairly going to target us. Because what's going to happen is a right to die is going to become a duty to die. Because we as African Americans haven't had the opportunities to make as much money over our lifetime as our white counterparts. So what happens is we don't have enough money to sustain our lives at the end of life. And then society is going to put pressure on us to end our life, even though we might not have a terminal illness, just because we're an inconvenience and we're costing money. The insurance companies caught on. And I've heard a story of an insurance company that refused to provide cancer treatment for somebody who had cancer that could have been fought off, but said instead, we'll pay for your coverage to get these pills that'll end your life. You just got to pay $1 out of pocket. These are the issues that are welling up, and these are not the things you hear spoken about in culture, but we as a church, we need to stand up and say, no. We stand up for the dignity of life at the beginning of life, the dignity of life at the end of life. We are a people who are about life because all people are created in God's image and deserving of protection and deserving of being spoken for. But that's not the only angle we approach it at. Remember earlier, the dollar bill smells like a bunch of stuff, fecal matter, we talked about that. There's other angles we need to approach this from, which means number four, the other angle. The other angle. I am convinced that most Christians would be willing to protest a Planned Parenthood, but wouldn't be willing to enter into the neighborhood surrounding a Planned Parenthood and love on the communities in those areas. Because that's where it gets messy. It's easy, and it's not wrong, but it is easy to have a bumper sticker. It's easy to put something on your Facebook profile. It's difficult to form relationships and to minister to people who are at high risk for abortions. And some of the ministries that I've fallen in love with, and I love to track what they're doing, are these ministries that, yes, they put the truth out there, but they're on the ground in the communities helping these teenage mothers who are in the direst of circumstances where abortion seems like the best idea. And they're in these communities and they're saying, hey, how can we help? How can we love? How can we serve? How can we get you plugged into a church where people are going to love you, serve you, care about you? Because see, that's what as Christians we need to be concerned with right now alongside of presenting the truth. We want to minister holistically. And how did Jesus minister? He ministered in what? Grace and truth. We don't want to just present the truth, but we also want to present grace to those who have had abortions. We want to present grace to those, and we want to be a voice for those and a helping hand for those people who are in those situations where that seems like the best opportunity. And I think when we begin to embrace this, the world will see of Christians what they saw 1700 years ago in Rome, where we were caring for people and loving people. And we were doing that because what? God calls us to love our neighbor. Nicki Minaj, she's a famous pop culture artist. She talks openly about her regret of having an abortion. Lecrae, a Christian rapper, he forced his girlfriend, drove his girlfriend to an abortion clinic here in Memphis to have an abortion, and he talks openly about his regret of doing that. And as a church, are we willing to not only stand up for what is true, but also stand in the grace of God and minister to these people who are in these circumstances? Because the thing we've got to remember is we all need Jesus' grace. Remember, we can't justify ourselves. Remember, we can't perfectly love God and love our neighbor. If you look at 1 John chapter 3, verse 15, this puts everybody on a level playing field. This is 1 John chapter 3, verse 15, and it says this: everyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Everyone who hates his brother. So even though you might have never murdered, you might not have the physical blood on your hands, you might be a murderer in God's sight if you've ever engaged in hating your brother. Everybody's on a level playing field. And we all need God's grace. So here's how I want to do it. There's a video I want to show real quickly. It's about a 3-minute video. This is a video of a young mother named Crystal who got pregnant in her teenage years. And there's a ministry called Young Lives. It's a part of Young Life. And they're actually present here in Memphis. And I say this as an opportunity. Some of you are like, hey, Jason, I like what you're saying, and I want to be on the ground level with this. Young Lives is an awesome ministry to be involved in. And I would love to get you in contact and to help you get plugged in and maybe make this a reality where you're serving alongside some of these teenage mothers and helping serve them. But Crystal is a teenage mother. And Young Lives is a ministry that specifically ministers to young women in high school who have children. Those who are at risk, most at risk for abortions. And they're saying, hey, you know what, we're going to call this what it is, but at the same time, we're going to love with grace, mercy, and we're going to enter into these situations. And I just want y'all to check out this video and to see how this type of ministry has changed this young girl's life. So Chelsea, you can go ahead and hit play.
I'm sorry.
You got it.
There it is.
I wasn't really a teenager that liked to party or anything. I didn't really go out with my friends because I didn't really want to. I would isolate myself a lot. I put a face to the world that I was a happy girl, but it wasn't really like that inside. That was like very, very sad. I needed somebody. I just didn't want people to know like the real true story behind all that smile I had. I dated my boyfriend, and then that's when everything went downhill. We dated for like a year, and then I found out I was 7 months pregnant. They're like, you're due like in 2 months. As a teenage mom, my life is very hectic. I work, I go to school. It's very hard to handle 2-year-old and work and school. Other teens don't know that you have another responsibility besides your homework, besides like doing chores. You have to take care of a little baby. You have to find a way to give them milk, bottles, diapers, change them, stay with them. And that's where it's difficult keeping friends. And I lost all my friends, all of them. That's when I went to my counselor and I told her, I need people there for me. And she gave me this flyer and she's like, here, call her. So I called the Young Lives director, Myrna. She just helped me, like,
the first time I talked to her, I cried. It was just very hard.
to the point where I wanted to kill myself so bad that I overdosed myself and they had to pump my stomach. She helped me a lot. When I met her, it was like I had somebody I could talk to. I wanted to know that God was real. And she showed me the path, and God is so real to me. I pray to him all the time. Because it felt like he was my own father.
Young Life changed my life. I wanted to give myself to God. I wanted him in my life, and I wanted to feel the joy everybody felt when I would see them speak about him. Now my heart changed. Like, now I want to give. I want girls to experience the love I experienced from Jesus, and I want them to know that we have people that want to pour into them. I see differently now. I want my daughter to love God. I want her to know that there is a God that loves her, and I want her to know that I will always be there for her, and he will always be there for her. And I look back, and I'm like, wow, like, I changed. It's wonderful what God does.
You know, I love that video because that shows what happens when we love our neighbor, and that shows the power of God and his grace and his mercy to enter into an untenable situation and to just demonstrate how awesome he is. And so as a church, we want to minister holistically. We want to call what truth is, we want to call it truth, but at the same time, we want to love people. That means loving the baby, that means loving the mom, that even means loving the dad and trying to just enter into these situations. But here's the last question I have for you. We'll be done. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? Well, like, this could be, just be one giant guilt trip, right? Like, oh man, I need to do this. Oh, I need to change that. And that's not my intention, nor is it the Bible's intention. Because the motivation for us as Christians is never guilt. We're never trying to be good people so that God would love us. We are people who are recipients of God's grace and mercy in the same way that the beaten man was recipient of the love and mercy of the Good Samaritan. See, in the story of the Good Samaritan, it's not just some parable. It's all of our stories. Because Jesus, in the story, is the Good Samaritan. He's the one who is infinitely different than us and had all the resources and had no reason to get off of his horse. But what did it say about the Good Samaritan? It said the Good Samaritan showed compassion on the beaten man. And you know what the word is that constantly describes the way that Jesus looked at us in the Gospels? Compassion. He had compassion on them. He had compassion on him. He had compassion on her. And when Jesus looked at you in all your sin, beaten and broken in the struggle of sin, he had compassion on you. He was willing to get down off of his perch, come down into this world, carry your burdens, pay your price, so that you, in your beaten and bloody and broken state, could be lifted up. Before we were ever called to love our neighbor, we have been loved infinitely by Jesus. And that's what we want the world to know. And that's why we do what we do. So what we're going to do now is we're going to pray. We're going to pray over these situations, these circumstances, all the things we've talked about. And then what we're going to do is enter back into worship, and we're going to worship a God who loves us in such a radical way and has so much power and so much grace and so much mercy that he turns broken situations into trophies of his grace. So bow your heads with me. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do thank you so much for this church. Lord, one of the things that is just so incredible about our church is that we can have these conversations. We can have the tough conversations about needing to love people. We can have the tough conversations about entering into the brokenness and really discussing some of our differences but still loving each other afterwards. We can have the tough conversation about some of the hot-button cultural issues. And we are all, as a church, willing to submit ourselves to your words. And we're all willing to look at the world through the lens that you would have us look at the world through, which is the Bible. And so as people who do that, first and foremost, we seek to love our neighbors. And God, what that means is we're a voice for the voiceless. We speak out when things that are happening are wrong. And God, when we stand by the truth of what's really happening when it comes to abortion. But God, in our zeal to do that, would we never be people who view this as a ballot box issue alone, or only view the baby in the scenario? Because, Lord, I've heard people criticize the abortion movement for overlooking the baby, but we can criticize Christians for overlooking the mother, overlooking the brokenness in the situation. But God, would we not be a people who do that? Would we be a people who enter into the lives of people like Crystal, who are so upset about what's happening in their lives and see such hopelessness that they try to take their own life like she did? And recognize that we have the hope of the world in Jesus Christ. And God, if you can turn a bloodstained cross into an empty tomb, you can turn any scenario or situation we find ourselves in into victory. And you promise that you will do that for those of us who are in need. So Lord, would we be a church that's an agent of change? And would we do so not as a church seeking to justify ourselves, because we can't do that. Would we never approach it like the lawyer approached it? Well, did I do a good enough job? God, did you love me? No. Would we recognize that you are the Good Samaritan? Instead of getting off your horse, you came down out of heaven. Instead of paying for our hotel room, you paid our sin debt on the cross. Lord, instead of us just being broken and beaten by the side of the road, we were dead in our trespasses and sins. And so, Lord, if there's anybody in this room who doesn't know that, may that first and foremost be what you're working into their heart right now, where they would give their lives to you. And God, if there's anybody in this room who's connected to somebody who's had an abortion or has any sort of situation where this is a part of their story, God, would you show them that your grace, love, and mercy is strong enough and real enough to cover that sin? And that you love them and you have them here for a reason, so that they can hear the truth and the hope of that. And so we'd be a church, Lord, who would minister in the hope that we have. Lord, once again, I thank you for this church. I consider it an honor and privilege to get to be a part of it, because it's just so different in the way that we enter into these issues. And we love each other and we wrestle with them. And we ultimately, at the end of the day, get to see your glory and love for us, and that propels us out into the world. Have the hard conversations, and to do the hard work of loving our neighbor. It's in Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Now we can stand and worship.